Okay, then I'm sharing my screen. Just check whether screen is visible. Now tell me, my screen is
Yes,
visible?
sir.
It is visible to
Yes, sir.
everyone.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay, very good.
Yes, sir.
Now see, this thing last time we have studied. What we have studied is frequency of oscillations for this Wien bridge oscillator. This is RC phase shift oscillator that already we are done with. Then Wien bridge oscillator we started with. And then after a discussion, we concluded that this is a feedback network of Wien bridge oscillator, and feedback network is not there to provide a phase shift. So as a feedback network is not giving any kind of phase shift to us, then why we are using that feedback network? So basically, we are using that feedback network to adjust the frequency, of oscillations. That's the job of that feedback network. So now the feedback network is there to adjust the frequency of oscillations. Then we derive the equation for the frequency of oscillations. Is it? We started with this, and finally we got this equation. It shows beta is equals to this. Beta means what? The feedback factor. Is it? Or what I can say in rough language is the gain of feedback network. Now, from this equation, we have taken out imaginary part. Why we have taken out imaginary part? Because imaginary part always produces phase shift. Is it? So phase shift is there because of that imaginary part. Imaginary part is always responsible. And I don't want any phase shift from this feedback network. So it means imaginary part, I need to keep it as in zero. So I kept imaginary part is equals to zero from this equation. Just check it out. From this equation, imaginary part I kept equals to zero. And finally, what I have concluded with, this equation, f is equals to 1 divided by 2 pi RC. It means this frequency, look at this, frequency is depend on two components, that is resistor and the capacitor. If I change the value of resistor or if I adjust the value of capacitor, I can adjust the frequency. Like this, I can design Wien bridge oscillator for any desired frequency. I can adjust the frequency of oscillations for this Wien bridge oscillator. Is it? Now, see, just we need to adjust the value of resistor or the value of capacitor. It means either you connect a pot in your feedback network or you connect a gang condenser, a gang capacitor or gang condenser in that feedback network. By that, I can change the frequency of oscillations. Right? Now, this is about the frequency. This is about the imaginary part from this equation. Now, let me rewrite this equation here again. Let me rewrite that beta is equals to, let me remember that it is R divided by 3R plus 1 divided by J omega C. That's what plus, I think one term still we are missing, that is R or V J omega RC. That's what we write generally. Otherwise, by simplification, we can write R square and J or J omega R square C, whatever, just whatever we have written, we followed that thing only, is it? Now, in above part, we kept this part, that is imaginary part, is equals to zero because I don't want any phase shift. Now, what is remaining? Remaining is real part, that is beta is equals to R divided by 3R. That is the real part. Now, as I'm saying that imaginary part is responsible for phase shift, then what about this real part? Real part is responsible for attenuation. Attenuation. Or in other language, what I can say, it is related to magnitude. It is magnitude or just simply amplitude. If there is a wave, and we are expressing that in the form of equation. And if there is a real part and imaginary part in the equation, then imaginary part shows its phase, whereas the real part shows its amplitude. And that is well known to everyone, is it? इधर आप लोगों को माहिती है ना दैट इमेजिनरी पार्ट ऑलवेज शो फेज शिफ्ट वेयर एज दिस रियल पार्ट शोज एटेन्यूएशन और मैग्नीट्यूड और द एम्पलीट्यूड ऑफ अ सिग्नल. नाउ दिस इज व्हाट माय रियल पार्ट एंड दिस रियल पार्ट इज नाउ व्हाट इट इज शोइंग. इट इज शोइंग अ मैग्नीट्यूड ऑफ द सिग्नल और द एटेन्यूएशन क्रिएटेड बाय द फीडबैक नेटवर्क. इज इट सो ऑब्वियसली दैट इट्स अ टू स्टेज amplifier, so attenuation will never be there, that is by common sense we know. Now let me put this R divided by 3R. What is that exactly? It is beta, it will be 1 divided by 3, because R I can cancel it. So beta, finally I am concluding with beta is equals to 1 divided by 3. What is that beta? It is basically a gain of feedback network. That's what a gain of feedback network. Now that gain of feedback network, why I'm concerned with this gain of feedback network? Because to create oscillations, see, it is a Wien-Bridge oscillator and that oscillator has to create a sustained oscillations, am I right? And to create sustained oscillations, one must satisfy the Barkhausen's criteria. You remember that? That is Barkhausen's criteria, is it? That what is that Barkhausen's criteria? The condition is total phase shift around the loop must be 360 degree. That is first condition. And second condition is the overall gain, or what I can say, the product of gain of an amplifier and the gain of feedback network must be greater than or equals to 1. So obviously, it's a Wien-Bridge oscillator. So in Wien-Bridge oscillator, we are using two stage amplifier. Is it? So as I'm using two stage amplifier, the gain product, that is A multiplied by beta, will be obviously greater than 1. Single stage amplifier gains are around more than 1. So obviously if I'm using two stage amplifier, the gain of my circuit will be obviously greater than 1. So this thing is very easy for us now. But see, let us keep that A multiplied by beta, that should be greater than or equals to 1 as in Barkhausen's criteria. Look at this. This is what my Barkhausen's criteria. Now what is the value of beta in case of Wien-Bridge oscillator that I have derived? It is A multiplied by beta is 1 by 3. So it is 1 by 3 should be greater than or equals to 1. It means I can write A must be greater than or equals to 3. Now what is this? This is another condition or criteria I have derived for this Wien-Bridge oscillator. It means if I am having two stage amplifier, the gain of that two stage amplifier must be greater than 3. Is it? See, I'll write here in words, the gain of two stage amplifier must be greater than 3, then only your Wien-Bridge oscillator will produce sustained oscillations. Because see, one condition from the Barkhausen's criteria already we have satisfied, because it is a two stage amplifier. One stage gives us 180 degree phase shift, another stage is giving another 180 degree phase shift. Like this, total phase shift A will be 360, and that is done. Now come to the second condition. A beta should be greater than 1. In my case, that is for Wien-Bridge oscillator, A should be greater than 3. So it means your two stage amplifier should give us gain greater than 3. And that is very simple. Even with the minimum criteria, the gain of two stage amplifier will be always greater than 3. Even that gain is too large actually. If I design two stage RC coupled amplifier, then the gain of that amplifier, look at this, for example, if I say the gain of two stage amplifier is equals to A, then how I can represent the gain of two stage amplifier? that is gain of first stage multiplied by gain of second stage. Now if I design single stage amplifier with the gain of just 5 and second one is also having gain of 5, then total gain will be 25, is it? Like this, the gain will always be greater than 3. Even if I can consider the last semester example that we have designed RC coupled amplifier, a single stage RC coupled amplifier for the gain of 20. So imagine 20 multiplied by 20, because I am considering that I am connecting two identical amplifiers. Look at the gain. It will be greater than 3. Yes, obviously it will be greater than 3. So it means satisfying this criteria, that is gain must be greater than 3, is so simple. It is so easy. So that's why we should not worry about the Barkhausen's criteria in case of this Wenbridge oscillator. Anyhow, it will be satisfied automatically. Why? Because two stage amplifier we are using, phase shift and gain, both criteria can be satisfied with this two stage amplifier. Is that? So this is about the Wenbridge oscillator and the frequency of oscillations for this Wenbridge oscillator. Now the part which is quite important is, let me check, people are there? Guys, are you there? Anybody, please reply.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes,
sir.
Yes, very good.
Yes, sir.
Yes.
How many students are there? Total 56 students are there. Let me check randomly. Rashik, are you there? Gauri?
Yes, sir.
Very good. Samiksha?
Yes, sir.
Okay, let me continue then. Now, it's our job to design this Wenbridge oscillator. See, designing of Wenbridge oscillator, what it actually includes, see, a single stage RC coupled amplifier and cascaded with another single stage amplifier. Like this, what we have two stage RC coupled amplifier. This is what amplifier, and then there is a feedback network connected. Like this, this is what my feedback network, and this is overall my two stage Wenbridge oscillator. Now designing of this Wenbridge oscillator, it means we have to design two stage amplifier, and even I'm going to make the process very simple, because what I will assume that two amplifiers that I'm using here, that is in stage 1 and stage 2, I'm assuming that two stages are identical, is it? It means I'm connecting same amplifiers in series. So eventually what I need to do, I have to design a single stage RC coupled amplifier. Whatever component I have calculated for this first stage, I will connect same components for the second stage. Like this, I am just reducing our work. We are just trying to save the work, is it? And see, nobody will ask you why you are doing this, because you are the designer. What the concern is, sustained oscillations. Anyhow, you have to provide the sustained oscillations. Now, no matter whether you are designing this stage separately and you are designing this stage separately, you are going to design this stage of amplifier with some other components and with this with some other components, it will never matter at all, is it? The matter is output voltage and the frequency or the waveform or sustained waveforms is the matter of concern, is it? So let me take a proper design example. Guys, do you have notebook with you?
Yes, sir.
Yes, yes, I hope, sir. Notebook and pen is there with you. Now, what you do? You start designing this two-stage amplifier or the total Wenbridge oscillator with me. So, can I detect then a design problem? Okay, I'll write here. I will just write the given things. You elaborate the complete sentence. For example, write it down. Are you writing? Can I detect then?
Okay,
yes, sir.
Yes, so write down design.
Yes,
when
sir.
Okay, design Wenbridge oscillator for following specifications. Design Wenbridge oscillator for following specifications. Now, what are the following specifications? First specification is frequency. Frequency given is 10 kilohertz. And then output voltage, that is peak to peak, it is given as 10 volt. And then VCC is also given, that is 20 volt. And the power dissipation of a transistor, it is given, power dissipation of transistor, it is around 500 milliwatt. And then VCE max, which is given 45 volt. Then IC max, see this VC max, IC max, those are the specifications of a transistor they have given. It is 100 milliamperes. What else they have given? HFE is also given. HFE is given as 330. And HIE of a transistor is also specified, that is 4.5 kilo ohm. See, those are the specifications they have given. And our job is to design Venn bridge oscillator. So I hope you are done there. It is done?
Yes, sir.
Reply that, sir, anyhow. Because now see, it's an online class. Nothing is recorded actually. I supposed to record the things and then I supposed to share. But see, we didn't get any time. आपल्याला वाटलं नव्हतं ना की हा सेकंड वेव पण येईल, सेकंड वेव ऑफ कोरोना व्हायरस. सो लेट अस स्टार्ट विथ. नाउ डू वन थिंग, यू मॅडम सांग लेक्चर सोडून. What I have done, sorry. Now keep some space for circuit diagram. No need to draw the circuit diagram. Why to waste our time to draw the circuit diagram? Is it? You draw it whenever you get free time. As if we are starting with this design of Venn bridge oscillator, you have to write a clear note in Venn bridge oscillator. I will dictate, you write down, okay? Yes, no, say something.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Very good. Now write down. As we are designing Venn bridge oscillator, we will assume that two stages of amplifier are identical. So let's design single stage RC coupled amplifier. Next line, to design an amplifier, let's fix Q point of a transistor. That we'll fix first. Q point of a transistor. Now see what you have written, that we are assuming that two identical amplifiers I have connected in series, that is in multi-stage amplifier. More than one stages are there. And I'm assuming that first stage is exactly same as the second stage. So it means eventually I just need to design only single stage, and whatever components I calculate for the first stage, same I will copy there for the second stage. Is it? So that's why. Now see, let us start with the regular procedure for the designing of single stage RC coupled amplifier. So what we have decided to fix its Q point. So let me write it down. VCEQ is equals to, now which is well known, VCC divided by 2. Just check how much VCC is given. VCC is given
20 volt.
Yes, it is 20 volt. So 20 by 2 means eventually I'm writing 10 volt. So VCEQ, the value is 10 volt. What about ICQ? See, ICQ is not given anywhere. ICQ is not given. So when ICQ is not given, then we have to assume that ICQ is not given. So here I will write that assume ICQ as 10% of IC max. Now see, IC max is given. How much IC max is? 100 milliampere. So 10% of 100 milliampere is 10 milliampere. So now 10 milliampere is the value of ICQ and 10 volt is the value of VCQ. So what will be the Q point then? My guess, Q point will be 10 volt, 10 milliampere. It is done. Say yes, no,
yes,
say yes, very good. Say something. So for a single stage RC coupled amplifier, we have fixed the Q point for a transistor, 10 volt and 10 milliampere. Is it? Now, after that, what we will do? We will calculate the value of emitter resistor RE. Is it? And it is well known how to calculate RE, the voltage across resistor RE divided by what is the current flowing through that RE. Is it? Now, what is the value of VRE? Generally, we assume VRE is 10% of VCC. 10% of VCC. So, what is the value of VCC? It is 20, I think. So, 10% means it is 2 volt. And what about IE? IE, we know that IE is approximately nothing but your IC, which is nothing but ICQ. So what is the value of ICQ we have? It is 10 milliampere. So now 2 volt divided by 10 milliampere. Tell me what's the answer?
0.2.
Kilo madhe sangta ka madam apan?
Kilo.
Okay. Point madhe kilo nahi sangayacha. I told you so many times that you write 200 ohm na, barobar hai na? So instead of writing 0.2 kilo, it's better to write 200 ohm. So value of RE we have calculated as 200 ohm. Is it? Now after RE, let me calculate. Sorry. Anybody has problem? You all are done with this 200 ohm?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Yes, sir. Very good. Now see, let us calculate RC after that, RE. What is that RC? That is collector resistor. Is it? It is collector resistor. Now, how to calculate? Let me apply KVL to the output loop. So, if I apply KVL to the output loop, let me show here. This is what... look at this, this is RC and here it is VCC, this is what my ICQ, this is what VCEQ and this is my VRE. I'll write here VRE. So what will be the KVL then? VCC is equals to ICQ multiplied by RC plus VCEQ plus VRE. Now see, out of this VRE is known, VCEQ is known, even value of ICQ is known, VCC is known. Now it is very simple to calculate value of RC. Just calculate the value of RC and tell me the value. Do it fast, guys. Hope you are doing this. How much it will be? Come on, do it fast. VCC minus VCEQ minus VRE divided by ICQ. That's what the equation. So what VCC is 20, VCQ is 10 minus what's the value of VRE we have calculated? How much VRE? Okay, 2 I think. Yes, divided by 10 milliamperes. So it means
800.
Yes, 800. 8 divided by 10, it will be 800 ohm. So value of collector resistor is 800 ohm we have calculated. It is done?
Yes, sir.
Yes, very good. Now see value of RC we have calculated. Let us calculate the biasing resistors R1 R2 now. Let me write calculation for biasing resistors. Biasing resistors R1 and R2. See the previous procedure to calculate value of R1 and R2, that is biasing resistors, in last semester we have taken help of that stability factor S. In the example, the stability factor was given, and then from the equation of stability factor we started calculating the value of RB, then we calculated value of R1 and then R2. Is it? That's what process we have followed. Here the process is quite different. Is it? Let me change the process. Why? Because stability factor is not given. In case if stability factor is not given, you can assume stability factor S is equals to 10 and go ahead with your regular procedure as you have followed in the last semester. I hope it is clear. See, the stability factor is not given. Generally, what we know, what we understand, what we followed for the R1 and R2 calculation, stability factor, and depend on the equation of the stability factor, we calculate RB and then we calculate R1 and R2. Is it? So in case if stability factor is not given, then you assume the value of stability factor is equals to 10 and follow your own process that already you have done. Otherwise, the second procedure I will tell you here. Is it? This procedure using stability factor is well known to us. Now let us start with some new procedure. Is it? Because if you people are referring different books, then obviously you will find different methods to calculate R1 and R2. See, if you follow different methods, your values will be different. Is it? And I told you so many times that value does not matter to us. If I'm dealing with value of R1 and R2, the values doesn't matter at all. What matters is the proportion. Value of R1 should be always greater than the value of R2. Is it? The upper resistor, that is R1, is always greater. Is it? How much greater? At least twice of that R2. I hope you know that. Is it? We have discussed that so many times. The value of R1 should be larger. Is it? So at least त्याच्यात दोन पट तरी असायला पाहिजे. Minimum दोन पट असायला पाहिजे. Then only your design will work. Otherwise the design will never work. The proportion of R1 and R2 matters a lot for us. So no matter which procedure you are following, whether you are dealing or you are following the process that includes stability factor or the process that right now I will tell you immediately. So let us start with the new procedure to calculate R1 and R2. Now see, the value of R1 and R2 can be calculated by the current which is flowing through R1 and R2. So let me write here. I hope you are writing with me. Let Lita Nari Maja Barubar.
Okay, sir.
Very good. I hope you understood what I am doing now. Is it? I am following the different procedure to calculate R1 and R2. Why? Because ek procedure tari already tula maiti hai. Gelya semester la shikla hai na tumhi. Aani mag ata dusri procedure aata understand karun ghevuyat. Alternatives khup sare hai. There are so many, 5-6 methods are there to calculate R1 and R2. Even there are so many methods to calculate RC also. Is it? Kutli pick karaychi, that is our decision completely. No one will stop you or give you less marks if you follow the last year procedure, that is with the help of stability factor. Marks kami nahi milnar tula. अजीबात नहीं, नॉट एट ऑल, इट इज अ प्योरली वैलिड प्रोसीजर. इज इट योर वैल्यूज विल बी डिफरेंट. सो दैट्स वाय वैल्यू मैटर करत नाहीत आपल्याला. व्हाट मैटर्स इज द प्रपोर्शन. नाउ सी, लेट आई वन इज द करंट फ्लोइंग, आई वन इज द करंट फ्लोइंग थ्रू रेजिस्टर आर वन अँड आई टू इज द करंट फ्लोइंग थ्रू रेजिस्टर आर टू. असं काहीतरी म्हणूयात आपण आर वन अँड आर टू. After that, let assume I2 is 10% of ICQ. This is what my biggest assumption. In this new procedure, what is my assumption? I2, that is current flowing through resistor R2, is 10% of ICQ. So what is the value of ICQ? I think it is 10 milliamperes. This ICQ is 10 milliamperes. So 10% of 10 milliampere is 1 milliampere. So finally, I'm concluding with I2 is equals to 1 milliampere. Is it? Now, why I have assumed that? Because I'm interested in calculation of R2, resistor value. How can I get the value of resistor? Obviously, the voltage across the resistor divided by current flowing through that resistor. Is it? Now, the current flowing through that resistor I2, here I have calculated I2. Now the question is about VR2. What is that VR2? See, you remember that circuit diagram? One resistor, another resistor. I'm calling it as an R2, and this is what my transistor, and here it is emitter resistor, which is grounded. Now this voltage is what VBE, this voltage is what VRE. And this complete voltage is nothing but voltage across resistor R2. This is well known. So what is VR2? It is nothing but VBE plus VRE. So this is VBE plus VRE. Now VBE is 0.7. It is well known. VRE also we have calculated. What's the value of VRE? We have calculated 10% of VCC or something. Tell me how much VRE we have. It is 10% or 15% of VCC?
10% of
2 volt. Very good. So this is 0.7 and this is 2 volt. It means eventually what I am getting, 2.7 volt divided by 1 milliampere. Now tell me what will be the value of R2 then? Let me conclude. R2 will be then 2.7 volt divided by 1 milliampere. It is 2.7k. Far vel lagta kama nahi na. He kithe milli means what? 10 raised to minus 3. Ha minus 3 varthi gela andar plus 3 hoil na. So 2.7 multiply by 10 raised to 3. So it will be 2.7k. See, we have concluded with the value of R2 is equals to 2.7k. Now let us calculate the value of R1 also. Value of R1. Now how can I get value of R1? Let me write it here at the middle. R1 is equals to voltage across resistor R1 divided by what is the current flowing through resistor R1. Now what is that voltage across resistor R1? See, that one thing is known, VCC is divided across the voltage across R1 and voltage across R2. Now out of this, VCC is known, voltage across R2 is known. Voltage across R2, how much it is? 2.7 volt, is it? So this VR1 will be then VCC minus VR2. So it means 20 minus 2.7, am I right? So what will be the value of VR1 then? 20 minus 2.7, how much it will be? 17.3. That is the value of VR1. See, the numerator we have calculated, VR1. Now come to the denominator. What is that? I1. I1 is the current. This I am talking about. Look at this. Those who don't understand, for them I am drawing a extra circuit here. This is I1 and here somewhere it is R2 and this is R1. You remember that this is IB and I hope you know this is I2. Now from this KCL, am I right? It is KCL?
Yes, sir.
Okay, from the KCL, what I can write, it is I1 is equals to I2 plus IB. Now see, what I need is I1. I1 is I2 and IB, summation of I2 and IB. Out of this, I2 is known. We have assumed already I2. On the basis of that, we have calculated R2 also. So this I2 is known. What about IB then? Is there any way to calculate IB? Guys, can you help me? Is there any way to calculate IB? Can I take help of IC and HFE? Guys, am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Yes, okay, very good. So now IB, I am interested in IB, so I will write equation IC divided by HFE. Now in my case, this IC is nothing but my ICQ divided by HFE. Now the HFE is known. It is given in the problem, that is 330. ICQ, I think it is 100 milliampere. 100 or 10 milliampere? ICQ, what's the value of ICQ?
10 milliampere.
So let me write here 10 milliampere. Now look at this, 10 milliampere divided by 330 is the value of IB. 10 milliampere divided by 330. Now can you calculate value of IB? And if you calculate value of IB, then put the value of IB here in this equation of I1. Now this is what I1. I1 is equal to what? I2 plus IB. So what is the value of I2 we have calculated? I2 is 1 milliampere. So look at this. It is 1 milliampere plus IB. Can you tell me what is the value of IB? 10 milliampere divided by 330. How much it is? It will be in micro.
30.30 microamperes.
Look at this, 30.30 microamperes plus 1 milliampere is the value of I1. So now tell me what is the value of R1 then? R1 will be clearly 17.3 divided by 1 milliampere plus 30.30 microamperes. Now calculate fast and tell me what is the value of R1. And just make sure value of R1 should be greater than value of R2. Value of R2, how much we have calculated? Around 2.7k. So value of R1 must be greater than 2.7k. At least twice of 2.7k. How much it is? Come on, anyone.
Sixteen point seventy nine kilo ohm.
So 16.7k is greater than 2.7k. Yes, it is greater. It is greater than twice of 2.7k. Yes, it is greater. So it means whatever value we have calculated for R1 and R2 are the correct values. Is it? So now see, till now we have calculated R1, R2, RC, RE. See, resistors we have calculated. Now it's time to calculate capacitor, that is C in or C E or CC, whatever the values of capacitor. But see, calculation for the capacitor is always boring task. So what we will do, we will first calculate the value of feedback components and then we'll go toward the capacitor values. Is it? So now write down calculation for feedback components. Components and what is there in feedback network? Only resistors and capacitors. Is it? You remember the diagram? What we have in our diagram? Look at this. This I'm talking about right now. Where it is? Now look at this. I'm talking about the feedback network, RC. And RC. So let me draw that feedback network here itself. Here, one resistor, and one capacitor, and again there is a resistor and there is a capacitor. That's what. Now see, this is R, which is identical to this R. This is capacitor C, identical to this capacitor C. So that's why I am writing this R and C only. So are you ready to calculate feedback components, resistor and capacitor? Now let me have one equation. We have derived this F is equals to what? 1 divided by 2 pi RC. That's what the equation. Now tell me, what is the given frequency? Check your design statement and tell me what's the given frequency. How much it is? How much given?
10
kilohertz. So 10 kilohertz is the frequency. 10 kilohertz is equals to 1 divided by 2 pi RC. Now from this, can you tell me what is RC? That is time constant RC, something like R multiplied by C. How much it is? Just tell me that. Things are so simple. I'll tell you a simple thing, that calculate RC, depend on that frequency, and then we have to assume something and conclude that. Come on, tell me, what is RC? Guys, fast. Anybody, please, RC. Come on, first.
15.9 micro.
15.9 micro. Am I right?
Yes.
Now, see, RC is 15.9 micro. It means 15.9 multiplied by 10 raised to minus 6 is the value of product of R and C. Is it? Now, here, I will assume, I'll tell you why I am doing this. See, assume a value of resistor R is equals to 25k and calculate C. Now tell me, if RC is equals to 15.9 micro and if R is equals to 25 kilo, then what will be the value of C? It will be 15.9 multiplied by 10 raised to minus 6 divided by 25 kilo ohm. So tell me, what is the value of capacitor then? Take your time. I will tell you why I am assuming that R is equals to 25k. Is it? Because someone asked question, why 25k? I will assume 50k. I will assume 1000k. I can assume mega ohm value of resistor. So there is a specific criteria, a condition to assume the value of resistor. That's why even on your question paper, there is a line written that assume suitable component. So suitability is the most important thing. Is it? So now suitability, obviously someone somehow derived that suitability. So we'll discuss on that suitability immediately. So first tell me, what is the value of capacitor? Let me conclude this and then we'll discuss about resistor. Anybody?
1 nanofarad.
1 nanofarad is the value of capacitor. See, the value of resistor from the feedback network is 25k and the value of capacitor is 1 nanofarad. Those are the feedback components. Now, I will tell you why 25k I have assumed. See, you are free to assume any value, but it must be a suitable value. See, there is one one criteria, it's not criteria as such, there is one effect that is called loading effect. Loading effect that is considered while selecting the value of capacitor. Is it? Now, if you don't know what is loading effect, then on my YouTube channel, you will get a small video around 10 minutes about, no, it is less than 10 minutes. It will show you what is loading effect, is it? And that loading effect I'll teach you when we start with multi-stage amplifier also, is it? So when we start with this multi-stage amplifier, you will come to know what is loading effect. But in case if you want it immediately, then go to my YouTube channel, you will get a video titled what is loading effect, is it? But now here to avoid that loading effect. Is it to avoid that loading effect? I'll not discuss what is loading effect, but I'll just tell you to avoid this effect. This is a small effect. What we have to do, we have to put the value of register should be greater than the value of output register. Now see, we have amplifier, no? Single stage amplifier is in series with another single stage amplifier, and this complete structure we are calling it as an amplifier, that is multi-stage amplifier, is it? And feedback network is there somewhere. Look at this, this is a feedback network. The whole circuit we are referring it as an oscillator. Now this value of register we have to select such that it should be greater than output impedance of an amplifier. So for this complete amplifier, what is the output impedance? For this complete amplifier, output impedance is nothing but impedance, sorry, output impedance of second stage. So whatever impedance offered by the second stage will be the output impedance, is it? So it means what I can write, resistor should be greater than R02. So what is that R02? It is output impedance of second stage. That's what. So R must be greater than RO2 to avoid loading effect. Is it? Now what is that RO2? That is output impedance of a second stage for an amplifier. What is output impedance if you connect load resistor? I'll write here. If RL is there, then output impedance is always RL in parallel with RC. Is it? That thing we have already studied. But now in my case, for this design example, this RL is not there. So if RL is not there, then RO, that is output impedance, is always RC. It means in my case that value of R should be greater than or very very greater than value of collector resistor. Why only collector resistor? Because R02 is nothing but collector resistor for me. Why it is collector resistor only? Because RL is not there. Now what is the value of RC we have calculated? Can you tell me what is RC? How much we have calculated for RC?
15.9
micro. You're telling me RC, which is time constant, RNC. Now this is collector resistor. Collector resistor, very good. Now this is 800 ohm. So it means value of R should be very very greater than 800 ohm. बरोबर आहे ना? रेजिस्टरची व्हॅल्यू 800 ओहम पेक्षा खूप जास्त पाहिजे. सो खूप जास्त इट मीन्स मग मी काय केलं 25K केलं. इज इट? आता तुझ्या क्लासमधलं एखाद्याला वाटू शकतं की 25K म्हणजे खूप जास्त होत नाही. माझ्या हिशोबानं खूप जास्त म्हणजे 40K होतं. घेऊ शकतो, नो प्रॉब्लेम. एखादा म्हटलं की खूप जास्त म्हणजे मी 100 किलो घेणार, मी 1 मेगा घेणार. येस, नो इश्यू इन दॅट. इज इट? बट यू विल फेस प्रॉब्लेम वेन you calculate the value of capacitor. Look at this. I am assuming R is equals to 25K and that's why capacitor is 1 nanofarad. If I increase this value of resistor R to 1 mega, you will get value of capacitor very small. That much small that you will never get that value of capacitor in the market. Is it? So if you increase the value of resistor, obviously value of capacitor will decrease. So that's why you have to assume a suitable value for the resistor. Is it? Not like I want to assume as too much greater than 800. So assume it as 8 mega. No, don't do that. If you increase the value of resistor, the value of capacitor will decrease. So the capacitor value will be impractically very small. So, is it? So that is, I'm calling it as a suitability of components. Are you getting that? Is that clear to everyone? Very good. Now see, now we have calculated the feedback components also, the resistors we have calculated. Is it? Now it's time to calculate capacitor. But see, before calculating capacitors, let me select a transistor, a small part from the design. Now, how to select a transistor? Depending upon its IC max. depending upon this VCE max. Now, why I'm telling you IC max and VCE max? Because if you check your design, then it is given that IC max and VCE max. I have not used that VCE max ever. I have not used that power dissipation. It is also given, but I have not used it at all. So many things are given in design statement, but we don't use them. Is it? So those things are given for your reference to select a transistor. Is it? So depend upon this IC max, VC max and power dissipation and HFE, which is 330 given, you have to select a transistor from data sheet. So if I observe data sheet for BC547, a general purpose black package transistor, then what you will come to know that this BC547 is quite suitable for our design, because the power dissipation is more, VC max is also around 35 to 80 volt. So this BC547, a general purpose black package, is okay and which is completely suitable for us. So let us select BC547 and conclude it. Is it? So now what else is remaining? Only capacitors. What are those capacitors? Those are CE and CIN, or simply what I can say is coupling capacitor, CC. Is it? Now see one thing. Am I audible, guys? Hello?
Yes, sir.
Yes, audible properly. Very good. Now see, as I told you that capacitor CE and CC. Look at this. If you check, I have not written design statement. But if you check your design statement, then you will come to know that this okay, 1251. Guys, which lecture you have now after that?
EME.
EME lecture. Now, see, I will conclude that design. The CE. Okay, we have very less time now. So here. CE. How to calculate the value of CE? See, CE. For CE, we have XCE is equals to 10% of how much? 10% of RE, is it? And what is that XE? It is 1 divided by 2 pi FCE. But here the frequency you have to consider as, what's the given frequency? 10K. See, the same process we have to follow as we have followed in the last semester. Is it? And then CIN, how you will calculate the value of CIN? For CIN, you have to calculate XCIN, which is 10% of RIN. How you will calculate RIN in that case? RIN will be R1 in parallel with R2 in parallel with HIE. So calculate this value, because HIE is known, R1 is known, R2 is known. Put it as RIN, then calculate XCIN. But what is that XCIN? XCIN is 1 divided by 2 pi FCIN, and what is that F? It will be 10 kilohertz. Is it? So like this you calculate for values for CIN and CE. Is that clear? Guys, is this clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay, now see, I will stop my screen sharing, because what happened? Aapla time samplay na tha. So see, eka lecture madhe aapla ek design fakta complete zhala. And how many students are there? Total 60 students are there. Very good. I'll download the attendance. See, I have downloaded the attendance now. After that, see, up to 22 we have to finish two chapters. This one we are about to finish, and after that we have to finish power amplifier. The video lectures for the power amplifier is already uploaded on the YouTube channel, so I will share it and I'll discuss that afterwards. for the time being, you all are requested to leave the meeting. I hope you understand that. अरे तो वेन ब्रिज ऑसिलेटर डिजाइन सगळं समजलं का रे? इट इज ओके?
यस
ना? ओके, वेरी गुड. ठीक आहे देन. थँक यू, थँक्स अ लॉट. तुम्ही आता ईएमएस लेक्चर जॉईन करा, ही मीटिंग लीव करा फास्ट. ओके, बाय गाईज.
दुसरी मालक.